Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to CSTV. I'm your host, Kathleen Egaldoto, and this is The Striker. Kindly remember to subscribe and give this video a thumbs up. Today, The Striker leads us to Lamu County. Have it through and thrill. Now, 2 days ago, there was a suspected Al-Shabaab attack in Lamu that left six people dead and several others in Chad. Now, while the attack has been confirmed that actually there was an attack, there's no enough evidence to point out that these attacks were carried out by Al-Shabaab. And this has raised a number of concerns and questions whether it's actually an Al-Shabaab attack or it is a locally politically grounded or politically driven attack. And this is the case because these concerns come into questions because, number one, we know Lamu County as one of the most populated counties in the coastal part of Kenya. And therefore, the numbers in that particular county sometimes do determine the political outcome from the region. And we have also had cases of Al-Shabaab attacks in that particular county also. So, a first look at its proximity to Bonny Forest, it is proximity to Somalia, and the history of attacks that have actually taken place in that particular county. So it leaves the public and even the security agents actually in a dilemma of actually finding or conclusively saying the side that is actually or like the cause of attacks, all the attackers. And sometimes we cannot rely on maybe what Al-Shabaab comes out to say, because we know sometimes terror groups like carrying today, even if it is a politically instigated attack, and there seems to be a confusion on who the attacker was. Al-Shabaab can come out and say it's us who attacked to send the threats, the threatening messages, and to look like they're victorious, because that has always been the aim of all terror groups. But say that said and done, today I have a number of observations that I have made concerning terror attacks and attacks in the country. I was looking at the trend of attacks in this country, and I was like, in 2019, the DC-T2 attack took place in January. 2020, we also had, is it 2020? Yes, we also had another attack at the military airbase, at the U.S. airbase in the coastal part of Kenya again. And then, if actually this is also an Al-Shabaab attack in 2022, you see, so the question is, what is this significant about terrorist attacks and generally in the country? What is this that is significant about January in Kenya that terrorists could always want to attack at that particular time, especially the coastal part of Kenya? I think for me, it is something that we really need to dig deep into, because I don't find this consistency a coincidence, because it was January around 15th, and then January around 3rd, 4th, and then now it was January 2nd. So you see, it's consistency that we actually need to find out something deeper about it, if actually it is terror attacks. And then it also raises for me fears concerning the electioneering period and the kind of violence that we do experience in this country. If we start talking about politically instigated attacks, especially when we don't have like information or clear information on who is the actual attacker, then it sends down a chilly of waves, a wave of chills and a wave of fear among the public, because we are at the beginning of the year, we are 7 months to elections, and then we start getting these issues to do with politically instigated attacks. So the question is, if it is a politically instigated attack, where is the next attack going to happen on? Who are the next targets and so forth? And therefore, for me, it raises one major security concern that as we head to the election yearly month, or as we head to our general elections, any country, especially Kenya, that is facing a threat of terrorism from Al-Shabaab, violence from our 326 violent groups in the country, the likes of Mungiki, the likes of Chingoro, the likes of Cheshira Darajani, Cheshira Embakasi, Cheshira Mse, 42 Brothers, the Taliban, the Gaza, Atukujui, the 42 Brothers, Wachuku, Wanyanya, and so forth. All those groups. Like, we face violence from both outside, from Al-Shabaab, and also from within our violent groups in the country. We really need then a lot, and then we also face aspect of ethnic violence. So, you know, those are the three. It's a trichotomy of violence that can easily take advantage of each other, especially when we are going to the election yearling period. So, faced with this trichotomy of violence, it is a task to the bodies, that is the Ministry of Interior and the Ministry of Defense, actually to come up with a security protocol that's going to guard the country as at this particular time. And I'm saying this because we are going to have several campaigns and several rallies that are going to see people come together, a lot of people come together, and that coming together, you know, terror groups like hitting at the masses. So that also needs to be like, how secure are going to be our campaigns, are going to be our political gatherings. And then comes to our militias in the country. We have militias within the country. That's something that we cannot run away from. So the question is, how are we going to prevent these groups from being politically used to unleash violence to the presupposed political opponents? It has happened there before. 2017, 2013, 2207. We have had groups such as Mungiki. We have had the Kalenjin Warriors. We have had the Chingororo. We have had all these groups being mentioned even in the work report as having participated in unleashing political violence. So what modalities has the Minister of Interior and the Ministry of Defense put in place to ensure that these groups do not resurface or do not re-emerge in a different fashion and start unleashing violence, all being used to settle political scores? And finally, it's about ethnic violence, and this one emanates from the utterances and the pressure from our political leaders. We are accustomed to political leaders who stand in podiums and use ethnicity as a language to divide people, to ask for poor votes, to kill each other politically. So how are we going to ensure that ethnic-based hate is not used in our political campaigns and podiums so that it does not transcend or lead to ethnic animosity and violence? So first, with these three trichotomies, this trichotomy of violence, or that is attacks from Al-Shabaab, militias from within, and the ethnic based utterances that leads to violence, I do believe that Kenya as a country, as at this particular time, needs to be very, very careful. The leaders, the relevant ministries need to be very, very careful to make sure that this country does not go back to the hands of the dogs as it did in 2007 and 2008, post-election violence. Otherwise, dear brothers and sisters, security begins with you, and ensure that you actually report anything that you see suspicious within your locality. Don't turn against your brother because of politics. Politics comes and go, but life has to continue. And the most important thing, our political leaders kindly lead by example. Thank you so much, and let's meet next time in the strike. Agal Toto Kathleen, CSTV, have it true and real.